Hello friends, welcome to An Academy. Let's crack NEET PG. I welcome you all to yet another session of Gynae Obs here with me. And for today's topic, I have chosen clinical interpretation of cardiotomography of CTG. So we're going to learn the basics and how to interpret the CTG tracing of the fetal heart rate monitoring during labor and otherwise. Now let me tell you something about the platform. An Academy is India's largest learning platform, and if you get a plus subscription, you get access to unlimited live and recorded courses from India's best educators. You'll get daily live classes where you can interact with your faculty, you can ask questions, get your queries solved there and then. There are structured courses designed in line for your exam syllabus to help you prepare for the various postgraduate entrance exams like AIIMS and NEET and JIPMER. There are live tests and quizzes which you can take, you know, after completing a topic. You can go for the live tests also. There are tests and discussions as well. There's unlimited access, and that's most important because one subscription gets you access to all of our live and recorded courses to watch from the comfort of your own houses, you know, and in, you know, sitting in your room on your laptops, on your phone. You can check out the top educators that we have with us. Dr. Nikita Nanwani is associated with us. Dr. Preeti Sharma, Dr. Devesh Mishra, they are associated with us. You can check out the courses that are offered onto the platform. Apart from the 19 subject-wise courses also, there are batch courses, comprehensive courses that are there. You can check them out. Check out the ongoing courses in our platform and have a look at them as well. And as far as the subscription modules go, we have 3-month subscriptions, 6 months, 12 months, and 24 months. And you can choose the subscription that best suits your need. Like for example, if you're preparing for the NEET PG for next year, then it's quite economical if you take the 12-month subscription. Keep in mind that you have to prepare 19 subjects and, you know, there's a lot of course. So eventually in the end, you want time enough to revise the course as well. So you see here that the 12-month subscription is for rupees 25,000, and it turns out to be more economical if you take it at one go. And for those of you, for example, who are still in their third year and final year and they have started preparing for the post-grad entrance exams and are juggling classes and hospital schedule at the same time, or those who are working and have hospital duties to attend to and they want a slower pace of preparation, watching one or two classes every day, they can take the 24 months prescription as well, and you can see a subscription as well, and you see that it turns out to be more economical in the long run. About only 1250 rupees per month it will cost you. So friends, this is about the NEET PG subscription. Now let us start our discussion for today, which is clinical interpretation of CTG, right? So what is cardiotomography? Hello Tahira, welcome. I can see your message there. Now, what is cardiotomography and how do we perform this cardiotomography or CTG? So we have this machine here, which is the CTG machine, okay, right? And as we can see in this machine, I'm sure you must have seen this machine in your labor rooms, right? There's a monitor here on which the fetal heart rate pattern comes, and the contraction pattern also comes in the bottom, right? And you have a paper strip here which comes, so you have a graphical record also, right? That will come out, and you can continuously check the fetal heart rate with the help of this machine. And you can see these probes attached here. So there's one probe here that is called as the TOCO probe, right? So TOCO for uterine contraction. So this is the probe that is placed on the fundus, on the uterine fundus over the abdomen, and this takes care and measures the uterine contractions. This TOCO probe is for the contractions, and you have these two more other probes which are called as the cardio probes, right? Now these cardio probes, they are for assessing the fetal heart rate. So they are placed on the maternal abdomen where fetal heart rate is best heard, right? So this is the CTG machine that is used to perform the monitoring of the fetal heart rate and the contraction pattern, right? And you can see here in this figure here on this inset, this is the cardio probe that is attached, right? And this is the toco probe that is attached to the woman's, that is attached to the woman's abdomen. So the toco probe is somewhere near the fundus of the uterus, right here at the top. And the cardio probe is down below where the fetal heart rate is heard at the maximum intensity. And you can see this woman is holding a pen-like structure this woman is holding in her hand, and every time that she perceives a fetal movement, she's going to click on this pen, right? So she's going to click on it, okay? It's like a button. She'll click on it and it will be recorded onto the CTG paper strip, right? So this is to record the movement. This is to record the movement, right? So with the help of this CTG machine, we are able to use it in two different scenarios. We are able to use this for monitoring the fetal heart rate in two different scenarios. We perform one thing which is called as the non-stress test. And we do it a little differently, which is called as the CTG or cardiotocography. I want you to be clear that the basics of reading the trace and the basics of interpreting the fetal heart rate pattern are the same for both of them. The only difference is that this is non-stress. Non-stress means the woman is not under any stress. She's not in labor, right? So this test, NST, that is the non-stress test, is done for antepartum fetal monitoring. It is using the same machine using the same principles and using the same analysis of the fetal heart rate pattern, but NST is done for antepartum fetal monitoring when the woman is not in labor. Okay, she is not in labor. So that is the non-stress test. And when we do the cardiotocography, we are seeing the fetal heart rate also. We are seeing the contractions also. So this cardiotocography is a means for intrapartum fetal monitoring, done for intrapartum fetal monitoring, right? And this intrapartum fetal monitoring means that the woman is in labor and she is getting contractions, right? So that is the difference between the NST and the CTG, right? And both of these tests use the same principles of analysis. Now let's see what those principles are. Let's say we are performing a NST, non-stress test. The woman is not in labor. I just want to see if the baby is doing well or not, right? So when we perform the NST, we assess the acute condition of the baby, right? We assess the acute condition of the fetus. Alright, so right now when the NSTV is being performed, what is the fetus condition inside? How is the fetus doing, well or not? This is what we see in an NST. And what do we see in the fetal heart rate trace? First of all, NST is done for a full 20 minutes. First of all, remember that this trace is done for a full 20 minutes, right? Now, the speed at which the paper comes out, right? The speed of paper is set at 3 centimeters per minute, right? So 1 minute tracing is like 3 centimeters on the paper. Right. So for a 20 minute sitting, we have to see like a 60 centimeter strip of paper. Right. So we take a long strip of paper and on that strip, we analyze the fetal heart rate pattern. So what do we see in this fetal heart rate pattern here? We see three important things, my friends. We see the baseline fetal heart rate, the beat to beat variability and fetal heart rate accelerations. Now I will show you how, right? So we choose somewhere on this CTG trace, we choose an area of which is pretty long. So we choose at least a 2 minute segment. 2 minute segment means 6 centimeter strip, right? So somewhere here. So this is like a big segment, right, of uniform segment which I can choose. Now this is the peak of the fetal heart rate, bottom peak, bottom peak, bottom. You can see this, it is waving, right? It is wavering, right? So we draw a line somewhere between the peaks and the troughs. The peaks and the troughs, right? Peaks are the highest points, troughs are the lowest point. So somewhere between these peaks and troughs, we draw a line, and that is my baseline fetal heart rate, right? So I can see here it is somewhere around, this is 140, 120, this is somewhere around 130 beats per minute. That is my baseline fetal heart rate, right? Anything that is more than 160 per minute, that is called as fetal tachycardia, right? And if it's less than 110 beats per minute, that is called as fetus bradycardia, right? So for the fetus, the tachy and brady are different as adult people, right? So more than 160 per minute is tachycardia, fetal tachycardia. Less than 110 per minute is fetal bradycardia. So this is how you check for the baseline fetal heart rate. You check it over a 2 minute segment. Over a 2 minute segment, okay? So we need a long segment here, and on that we will see the fetal heart rate pattern. Now what about the beat to beat variability? We also check the beat to beat variability here, and you can see here, what does beat to beat variability mean? That instead of being a straight line, you can realize that the fetal heart rate, at one moment it is 110, at other moment it is 130, at another moment it is 140. So it is just a zigzag pattern, and that is called as beat to beat variability. So we check that also. Now what is the normal beat to beat variability? The normal beat to beat variability is about 5 to 25 beats per minute. Okay, so that is the normal beat to beat variability. All right. Now, you will not be asked to actually identify or count exactly how much is the beat to beat variability, but you can see if the baseline is wavering quite a bit like this. This is called as a good variability. And the next thing that we check is for the fetal heart rate accelerations, right? So we can see here that this is the baseline fetal heart rate. All right, this is what the baseline is, and suddenly there is a spike in the fetal heart rate, right? So it is like, you know, when you go out and you walk around and you have a jog or you run around and you come back, then your fetal heart rate increases, right? So that is exactly what happens with the fetus also, right? Movement, fetal movement increases the fetal heart rate. So fetal heart rate accelerations can coincide with the fetal movement. So fetal heart rate accelerations, they occur with episodes of fetal movement, right? And we can see that this acceleration, that the spike in fetal heart rate that has happened from baseline of 130, it has reached here 170. So that is quite good, right? So fetal heart rate accelerations is what we are going to see. So in this particular CTG trace, we see one acceleration, we see two acceleration, we see three acceleration, we've seen four acceleration. So this is a good NST. This is a reactive NST, right? So what is a reactive NST? When there are at least two accelerations, okay, in a 20 minute trace, at least two accelerations in a 20 minute trace, and each acceleration is at least 15 beats per minute and is at least for 15 seconds, right? So these questions exactly are asked in your exam, that what is the definition of reactive NST, right? So when there are at least two accelerations in a 20 minute trace, and each acceleration is at least for 15 beats per minute, at least lasting for 15 seconds in duration, that is called as a reactive NST, right? Now, antepartum fetal monitoring with NST is started after how many weeks of gestation? That is another important question that you have to understand, that when do we start monitoring the fetal heart rate with NST, all right? So we start antepartum fetal monitoring after 32 weeks of gestation, okay? When the fetus crosses 32 weeks, that is when we will start monitoring with NST for fetal well-being, right? So This test is done for fetal well-being, all right? And it is to be started after 32 weeks of gestation, right? That is because the reactive NST, that is because reactive NST means that the fetal autonomic nervous system is functioning well, right? Fetal autonomous system is functioning well. That is what a reactive NST means, right? So the fetal heart rate is under the control of fetal autonomic nervous system. And if the reactive NST is there, that means the fetal autonomic nervous system is functioning well. Now, normally the fetal autonomic nervous system is immature before 34 weeks, right? And this fetal autonomic nervous system is immature before 32 weeks. That is why the antepartum fetal monitoring is started after 32 weeks of gestation. And if you're monitoring the fetal heart rate with NST, how frequently should we be doing it? We do it weekly in case of low risk pregnancies. In case of low risk pregnancies, we do it weekly, and we do it bi-weekly in case of high risk pregnancies, right? So if the fetus is growth restricted, if the mother has hypertension or preeclampsia and fetus is at risk, so this is high risk pregnancies, right? Then we will do the NST bi-weekly. Otherwise, for routine monitoring in low risk pregnancies, NST is repeated every week, right? So this is how we look at the NST, and this is how we read it, and we have to do it for at least 20 minutes, and we have to see at least 2 acceleration in a 20 minute trace. Now, what does this fetal heart rate trace signify? If you look at this fetal heart rate trace here, you can see on the top of the graph here, this is the fetal heart rate pattern, all right? And you can look here that the baseline, have a look at this baseline. If I ask you to tell me the baseline, what is the baseline here? This is 140 here, this is 160 here, this is somewhere between 140 and 160, right? So this is somewhere, this is the baseline. The baseline is okay, right? The baseline is okay. It's near about 150 beats per minute, right? But as you can see here, the variability is very, very minimal, right? The variability is minimal. There is no nice zigzag pattern as we saw in the previous graph, right? So the variability is minimal, and we can see that there are no accelerations. There are no accelerations also in this entire graph for 20 minutes, right? So this is a non-reactive NST. Okay, so this is what makes the NST non-reactive. Whenever there are no accelerations in 20 minute period, that is called as a non-reactive NST. Okay, and on top of that, additionally, there the variability is also minimal. This is an additional finding, right? So when there are no acceleration, it is called as non-reactive NST. In this particular trace, we are also seeing that the variability is minimal. So what are the causes of this decreased variability? They ask you this question in exams. What are the causes of decreased variability? Now, decreased variability means that could mean that the fetus is having hypoxia, right? This variability is also under the control of the autonomic nervous system, all right? Variability is also under the control of the autonomic nervous system of the fetus. And when the fetus is hypoxic, when the fetus has brain damage, then the autonomic nervous system becomes dysfunctional, and that leads to decreased variability. So fetal hypoxia is one of the causes of decreased variability. But there are also certain physiological conditions in which the variability could be decreased. Certain physiological conditions also are there in which the decreased variability could be there. Like there can be fetal sleep. If the fetus is sleeping inside, right? Now, normally when we people sleep, we sleep for 7 hours, 8 hours at one go, na? So we sleep at one end together, and then we get up and do our work. Now, fetus on the other hand, inside the uterine cavity, right, inside the womb, sleeps in bursts of 75 minutes. So this fetus is going to sleep for 75 minutes, then wake up, move around, do activity, and then again sleep, right? So fetus sleeps in short intervals. So episodes of fetal sleep can also lead to decreased variability, right? The other thing which can lead to decreased variability is fetal maternal intake of sedatives, maternal intake of drugs like sedatives, right, and corticosteroids. These also lead to decreased variability if the mother is taking such drugs. The other important cause of physiological decrease in variability is prematurity, right? Like I told you, it depends upon the autonomic nervous system. So in a fetus who is premature, there is automatically physiologically going to be decreased variability, right? So this is about variability in the fetal heart rate pattern. Now, let's say there is a primi gravida at 37 weeks who comes to the OPD with complaint of decreased fetal movements for one day, right? So what would you like to do? There is a woman who comes with complaint of decreased fetal movements. What would you like to do? What test can we do? What is the test that we would like to perform under the such circumstances? Anybody? Yes, now the test that we would like to do is a non-stress test. It is a simple test. You can use a CTG machine for that, right? And we test for the NST, right? And if the NST is reactive, Tahira, yes, very good. CTG or NST, right? CTG or NST, the machine is the same, the interpretation is the same, but we call it as NST because the woman is not in labor, right? So NST, if reactive, means everything is okay, and she can be reassured, right? So if there is decreased fetal movement, then one can do NST. So this is one use of the non-stress test. Now let's talk about intrapartum fetal heart rate monitoring, in which we do cardiotocography. Now we will see the relationship of the fetal heart rate pattern with the uterine contractions. So what do we see in the fetal heart rate trace? Now look at this here. This is a trace where we'll analyze how the contractions are affecting the fetal heart rate pattern, or if they are at all affecting the fetal heart rate pattern. So again, we see the same things in the intrapartum fetal heart rate monitoring as well. We see the baseline, beat to beat, variability, accelerations, and we focus on the decelerations as well. So look at in this trace, what is the baseline fetal heart rate here? This is 120, this is 140. We take a segment and we draw a line there, somewhere there. So in this case, the baseline fetal heart rate is about 130 beats per minute, and that is normal, right? We can see the beat to beat variability. There is a very zigzag pattern of the baseline. So beat to beat variability is also good, right? As far as the accelerations are concerned, look at this. This is one acceleration. Right, from a baseline of 130, it has reached 150. So it is more than 15 beats per minute, right? And it is lasting for more than 15 seconds also. This is broad, so it is lasting for more than 15 seconds also. So normally we'll say this is acceleration. We'll count it as an acceleration. This is the second acceleration. This is another acceleration here, right? So accelerations are present. Can we see any decelerations in this fetal heart rate pattern? Can we see any drop in the fetal heart rate? No, we can't see any decelerations. The decelerations are absent. So this is a normal CTG trace. This is a normal cardiotocography trace, right? So this is how we see the or read the cardiotocography. We read the baseline. We check on the beat to beat variability. We see if accelerations are present. And we see if decelerations are present, right? So baseline, good, check. Variability, good, check. Accelerations present, good, check. And decelerations absent, that is good sign. So that is why this is a normal CTG or a reactive CTG. Very good, Tahira. Moving on, let's see what are the different types of decelerations that we see on the CTG trace. Can you identify the type of deceleration here? Can you identify the type of deceleration here? There are three types of decelerations: early, late, and variable decelerations. Okay, so we are going to talk about these three decelerations and we are going to see how we identify them. These are the three different types of fetal heart rate decelerations. So can you identify the type of deceleration here? So to identify the type of deceleration, very well, Tahira, this is early deceleration, right? So early deceleration, friends, is like a mirror image. Look at this deceleration here and look at the contraction here. We have to see that the contraction here is exactly a mirror image of the deceleration, right? Because if this is the contraction, this is the deceleration, okay? So if you see them together, you see that the fetal heart rate starts dropping. This is the fetal heart rate, okay? And the fetal heart rate starts dropping when the contraction begins. By the time the contraction reaches its peak, the fetal heart rate has reached its lowest point. And by the time the fetal heart rate contraction is completed, the fetal heart rate has come back to normal. That is what we see here, right? So the fetal heart rate starts to fall at when the contractions begin. When the contractions reaches its maximum intensity, the fetal heart rate at its lowest, and by the time the contraction has subsided, the fetal heart rate has come back to its normal level. So this is called as early deceleration, right? So look at this here. You can draw a line and you can have a look that these are early decelerations, okay? See, so the type of deceleration here is early. They are type 1 decelerations. And very, very important question asked in exams, where are these early decelerations seen? Where are these early decelerations seen? They are seen with fetal head compression. They are seen with fetal head compression. Okay, now how does fetal head compression occurs? Now when the fetus is delivering, right, and when the fetus's head is negotiating through the birth canal, there is fetal head compression that is going to happen, that is invariable, right? So it happens every time when the fetus's head negotiates through the pelvis. So there is fetal head compression. Now when the fetal head compression occurs, there is vagal stimulation. The vagal stimulation occurs, alright, in the fetus. And vagus stimulation, you know, decreases heart rate. So with vagal stimulation, there is decrease in fetal heart rate, right? When the head compression is relieved, when the contraction is over, right? When the contraction is over, all right, because the contraction is pushing the head down, right? So with contraction, there is head compression, vagal stimulation, decrease in fetal heart rate. When the contraction is over, the compression is relieved, right? The vagal stimulation is relieved and the fetal heart rate returns to normal, okay? And that is why fetal head compressions, which are invariably occurring in labor, early decelerations are commonly seen in the second stage of labor, and they are not ominous, they are not threatening, right? So early decelerations happen because of fetal head compression, and they are not ominous or they are not threatening, right? So they are not considered ominous, all right? Now the next type of fetal heart rate deceleration, identify this. Now there is the figure already has a clue here for you. There is some delay in the onset of deceleration, right? So you see that the contraction here has started, but the fetal heart rate is normal. The fetal heart rate starts dropping after some time. There is a delay of onset of deceleration as regard the uterine contraction. So this is the uterine contraction. This is the fetal heart rate pattern or fetal heart rate trace, and we can see that there is a delay in onset of deceleration, and the fetal the contractions have all come down, right? The contraction has been relieved. So this is the peak of contraction, and this is when the contraction is over. This is when the contraction is over. So when the contraction is over, the fetal heart rate is still low, right? So this is what is called as late deceleration. This is what is called as late deceleration or type 2 deceleration, right? And late deceleration is ominous because it is seen with fetal hypoxia. Late deceleration is seen with fetal hypoxia, right? And any other factor which will cause uteroplacental insufficiency. Any other factor which will cause uteroplacental insufficiency. What does uteroplacental insufficiency means? Uteroplacental insufficiency means that the placenta is not getting adequately perfused by maternal blood, right? So the placenta is insufficient, it is getting inadequately perfused by maternal blood, and any uteroplacental insufficiency can lead to fetal hypoxia. So such decelerations can be seen in conditions where there is maternal hypertension, right? Like preeclampsia, right? It can be seen when there is IUGR, that is also in that condition also uteroplacental deficiency exists. So this uteroplacental insufficiency, wherever there is, can lead to fetal hypoxia, can lead to late decelerations, right? If the woman is getting excessive uterine contractions during labor, right, that can also cause uteroplacental insufficiency. It can also lead to late deceleration. So I've given you three causes here of late decelerations: uteroplacental insufficiency, excessive uterine contractions during labor, and fetal hypoxia, right? So late decelerations are threatening. Why? Because they can signify underlying fetal hypoxia. Now let's talk about the third type of, before talking about that third type of deceleration, can you identify these two are the same? Can you identify this deceleration and this deceleration for me? What is the type one, first one, and what is the second type of deceleration? And they have kept them two together side by side, so you can help the, appreciate the difference between the two type of decelerations here. The first one here is early deceleration, right? And the second one here is late deceleration, right? So the first one is early, the second one is late, and you can appreciate the differences that this comes along with the uterine contractions. This early deceleration comes along with the uterine contractions, and late deceleration comes after the contraction, right? So this is late, this is delayed, right? Now moving on to the other type of deceleration. Now what can identify this type of deceleration now? Now as you can see here, this dropping fetal heart rate is coming and there is no relationship with the contraction. Here it is coming here. Here it is coming here. Here it is coming here. So there is no relationship with the contractions, right? No relation with the contractions. Right, and the drop in fetal heart rate is very rapid. Look at this. This is the fetal heart rate sudden drop. Fetal heart rate sudden drop. Right, so that the drop in fetal heart rate is also very rapid, and this type of deceleration is called as variable deceleration. This type of deceleration is called as variable deceleration, and variable decelerations are seen because of cord compression. Seen because of cord compression. Okay, so this is also asked in your exams. They give you questions that they can give you the diagrams to identify the type of decelerations. They ask you directly where early decelerations are seen, where late decelerations are seen, and where variable decelerations are seen, right? So variable decelerations are seen with cord compression. Identify this type of deceleration now. Can you identify this type of deceleration? Identify the type of deceleration in this fetal heart rate pattern. This is the fetal heart rate deceleration. Look at it. It is falling very rapidly. All right. There is a rapid drop in the fetal heart rate, and the other important thing here is it is bearing no relation to the contraction. So this is a variable deceleration. Okay, this is also a type of variable deceleration. Now the next fetal heart rate pattern, can we identify the type of this fetal heart rate pattern here? Very important pattern. Can we identify the fetal heart rate pattern here? Can you see some very different about this fetal heart rate pattern? Look, in this fetal heart rate pattern, what is happening is that, see, this is the baseline. What is wrong with this baseline? Normally, the baseline is something like this, right? What is wrong with this baseline? This variability is not there, right? So the variability is lost. Variability is lost. And instead, the baseline has a sine wave pattern. Very good, Tahira. This is a sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern. This is a sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern or a sinusoidal baseline. This is also called a sinusoidal baseline because there is a sine wave pattern. It's like a wave, okay? A sine wave pattern. Sine wave pattern of the fetal heart rate. And this is also considered very ominous and threatening because it is considered with anything that causes sudden fetal anemia. It is associated with sudden fetal anemia. All right. It is seen associated with severe fetal hypoxia. Severe fetal hypoxia, right? So these are the two conditions where sinusoidal pattern can be seen. Okay. Very good. Tahira, fetal anemia. Tahira, can you elaborate on the conditions which can cause fetal anemia? Can you think of conditions which cause fetal anemia? What could be the conditions which could give rise to fetal anemia? Like in RH incompatibility, there is an RH affected fetus. RH incompatibility affected fetus. Okay, that causes fetal anemia. RH incompatibility affected fetus. There can be intracranial hemorrhage. Intracranial hemorrhage during labor. If there is an intracranial hemorrhage, that means the fetus suddenly loses a lot of blood. Sudden fetal anemia can lead to sinusoidal pattern. Very good, Tahira. Fetomaternal hemorrhage and isovenization, sudden intracranial hemorrhage. In twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome also, when one twin is bleeding into the other twin, twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome also, one of the twins which becomes anemic suddenly can develop a sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern. So these are some of the causes where fetal anemia or the sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern can be found, right? Bleeding vasa previa also. Bleeding vasa previa. Okay. The fetal vessels start bleeding here in vasa previa, and that is why the fetal blood is lost. And this is another condition where sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern is seen. Right. Now, let's talk about certain questions, and that will help us wrap up the topic eventually. All right, so these are the basics that I wanted to highlight. And now let's talk about the kind of questions that are asked. So very direct questions have been asked in the past, like early decelerations on CTG signify. That's a very simple, easy question. We've already talked about that. They signify fetal head compression, right? Cord compression causes variable decelerations, right? Uteroplacental insufficiency and fetal hypoxia cause late decelerations, right? So you have to remember this, very, very important, the type of deceleration and the associated cause. This is what you have to remember. Moving on to the next question. Which of the following is not an explanation for decreased variability of the fetal heart rate tracing? Which of the following is not an explanation for decreased variability of the fetal heart rate tracing? So decreased variability can occur in which occurs in which conditions except, that is what they want to know. So with fetal sleep cycle, is there going to be decreased variability? Yes, I told you, physiological cause. Prematurity, yes, in premature fetuses also there is decreased variability. Maternal drug intake, yes, if the mother is taking drugs like sedatives or corticosteroids, that can also cause this thing. fetal stimulation, no, fetal stimulus, when the fetus is stimulated, when you yourself are stimulated, your heart rate increases, isn't it? Acceleration happens, variability increases, you're moving around when you're excited and stimulated. So fetal stimulation does not cause decreased variability, right? So fetal stimulation in fact causes increase in fetal heart rate, but it does not cause decreased variability. Whereas A, B and D are causes of decreased fetal variability, and decreased variability will also occur with hypoxia. Please do not forget that also. Okay, very well said, Taira. Now for the next question. Which among the following is the single most reliable sign of fetal compromise on CTG? Now this is tricky. Which of the following is the single most reliable sign of fetal compromise on CTG? Absence of declarations, absence of accelerations, decreased beat-to-beat variability, late decelerations or variable decelerations. Which is the single most reliable sign? I told you that decreased variability also happens with hypoxia, late decelerations also happen with hypoxia, variable decelerations happen with cord compression, and when the cord gets compressed, if the cord keeps getting compressed again and again, again and again, the blood supply to the fetus will be affected. So all of these lead to fetal compromise. But which is the single most reliable sign? Very good, Tahira, very extremely good. Decreased beat-to-beat variability, right? So if the variability is gone, that is too dangerous. If the variability is gone, that is too dangerous. Why? Because I told you that beat-to-beat variability depends upon the functioning autonomic nervous system, right? So if there is fetal acidemia, any fetal hypoxia, once there is fetal hypoxia, or when we also get hypoxic, we get acidotic after that. So fetal hypoxia will lead to fetal acidosis eventually, and this fetal acidosis is going to stimulate the chemoreceptors in the brain. It is going to stimulate the chemoreceptors in the fetal brain and going to affect the variability and are going to affect the beat-to-beat variability, and that variability is going to decrease. So if there is decreased beat-to-beat variability, it is considered as the single most reliable sign of fetal compromise, right? Absence of accelerations by itself is not ominous, right? So acceleration should be present in a fetal heart rate trace during labor, but if they are absent, that is not an ominous sign by itself. All right. Now moving on to the next question. Repeated variable decelerations are associated with all except. Now you can answer this question even by simple exclusion, even if you don't know anything about the other options. Repeated variable decelerations are associated with all except. Now we know that cord compressions causes variable deceleration, so this is not the answer here. Fetal head compression causes early decelerations, right? So this is your answer here, because we know that fetal head compression causes early deceleration. Cord compression causes variable decelerations, right? What about these conditions? What about these two conditions, post-term and oligohydramnios? You know that when a pregnancy crosses post-term, that when a pregnancy goes beyond 42 weeks, what happens? The amount of lichen decreases. The amount of amniotic fluid lichen decreases. What happens? What is oligohydramnios? Oligohydramnios is decreased lichen. Okay. Now a baby is surrounded by lichen all around, right? So there is this baby here, and that the cords are lying around in the amniotic fluid. If the amniotic fluid is going to decrease in amount, the chances of cord compression increase, right? So with decreased lichen, the chances of cord compression increases. right? And that is why variable decelerations can be seen, in these conditions, also in postterm pregnancy and in oligohydramnios. So the concept is the same, that variable decelerations happen because of cord compression. So any condition which predisposes to cord compression, in that variable decelerations can be seen, right? So A, B, C, in all of these conditions, variable decelerations are seen, but fetal head compression causes early decelerations. This I have already told you. Now let's look at this question. Now this is slightly tough question. A woman is in active labor. Her CTG trace shows a baseline fetal heart rate of 140 beats per minute with good variability. Which of the following is not considered non-reassuring? Not considered non-reassuring means which of the following is considered okay? Which of the considered is considered reassuring? So recurrent late decelerations, is it reassuring or is it non-reassuring? Recurrent late decelerations is reassuring or non-reassuring? It is non-reassuring, right? Recurrent early decelerations, reassuring or non-reassuring? Non-reassuring. Variable decelerations, non-reassuring or reassuring? Non-reassuring. Absence of accelerations alone is considered not ominous, right? So absence of accelerations alone is not ominous. That is why it is not considered non-reassuring. Whereas any of these decelerations, if they happen again and again, is considered a non-reassuring sign on CTG monitoring, right? Very good, Tahira. Now, how do we clinically manage with CTG, right? So it's very simple. Just remember that there is something which is called as a category 1 trace. I need you to remember just two things here. There's something that is called as a category 1 trace. That means absolutely normal. Okay, so if during labor the fetal heart rate is showing category 1 trace, that means there is absolutely normal. The fetus is doing well. And there's something which is called as the category 3 trace. Category 3 trace, which is considered absolutely abnormal. That is considered absolutely abnormal. Okay. Now, what is category 1 trace? Category 1 trace would mean that the baseline fetal heart rate is normal. That means that the variability is good. That means the decelerations are absent. And that means the accelerations, if present, very well, good. If they are alone absent, that is not a problem, right? So as long as the baseline is normal, the variability is good, and any decelerations in fetal heart rate are absent, right? It means it is an absolutely normal CTG trace. Whereas there is something which is considered as an absolutely abnormal CTG trace. Now, what is that? That is when there is absent variability with bradycardia. If there is absent variability with recurrent late deceleration, if there is absent variability with recurrent variable deceleration, and there is a sinusoidal fetal heart rate pattern, right? So these are the category 3 traces or absolutely abnormal traces. So if there is absent variability with bradycardia, abnormal. Absent variability with recurrent late decelerations, absolutely abnormal. Absent variability with recurrent variable decelerations, absolutely abnormal trace. And a sinusoidal pattern by itself is absolutely abnormal. So whenever we are monitoring the fetal heart rate pattern on CTG during labor, right, if we find a category 3 trace and that is considered absolutely abnormal, we have to expedite delivery. That is the use of this CTG, right? So the CTG is used to pick up the absolutely abnormal patterns. If those absolutely abnormal patterns are found, we have to achieve delivery faster. We have to expedite, hasten delivery. And how will we expedite delivery? We can do either a cesarean section, or we will go for instrument delivery, vacuum or forceps, whichever is safer and whichever can be done faster. All right, so that will depend upon the criteria of instrumentation, criteria for cesarean section, and that is a topic for another discussion. But what is important is that whenever we are monitoring with CTG, we are trying to look for this category. If we find this category 3 trace, then we want to deliver as quickly as possible, because that means that the fetus is getting affected because of hypoxia or some other problem, and that is why we need to achieve a quick delivery. We need to expedite delivery. And those category 3 traces are absent variability with bradycardia, or absent variability with recurrent late decelerations, or absent variability with recurrent variable decelerations, and a sinusoidal pattern by itself is also considered very threatening and ominous. All right, so this is how the clinical management, this is what you need to remember. What is category 1 trace, which is absolutely abnormal, and what is category 3 trace, which is absolutely abnormal. All right, so this has been my time here, and now I would finish the topic here. If there are any questions, Tahira, you are here, you can ask me. If there are any questions you feel that you want to get answered, I can take them right now. Somebody else had also joined us. We had Yamriya Rose. If you want to ask any questions, Jayesh Khadar, any questions, anybody? If there are no questions, then I will say goodbye for the day, and I will see you tomorrow again at the next session at the same time, that is 4 p.m. You can hit the bell icon for notifications, and you can subscribe to an Academy platform to see more such videos and sessions, right? And okay, Tahira, yeah, there is a question for you. You are asking indications of continuous CTG. High risk pregnancies are indications of continuous CTG. Let me write them down so that you will. Right. So you want to know the indications of continuous CTG. Well, the indications of continuous CTG are when we want to monitor, when we are so threatened that we want to see the fetal heart rate all the time. So any high risk pregnancy where the fetus is at increased risk during labor, we have a suspicion that the fetus cannot tolerate the stress of labor, right? That is going to be the indication. For example, IUGR fetus. For example, preeclampsia. For example, twin gestation. For example, pregnancy with previous cesarean section, right? In labor. There are many post-term pregnancy in labor. Or any, you name it and it is there, any post-term pregnancy in labor, or induced pregnancies, very, very important, induced labors. In spontaneous labors, usually they go by fine. If you are giving drugs from outside, inducing labor, then it is an indication for giving continuous cardiotocography monitoring. Tahira, the topic for tomorrow is a video session on the diagnosis of hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. And for the next coming topic, that is, we are going to do something in labor only, and we're going to do that. All right. So for tomorrow, it is a diagnosis of hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. When to apply fetal scalp electrode? Tahira, in our country here in India, we're not really doing fetal scalp electrode testing. Even in the highest of the centers, I have not seen it being done. Fetal scalp electrode. A fetal scalp electrodes are yes described at as methods for intrapartum fetal monitoring when the CTG is not as threatening. It is somewhere in between the category 2 tests, which we missed out, which we didn't do, and we want to take the decision whether we should continue with the labor or we should go for a cesarean section. So if I'm very conservative about the idea that no, I don't want to do a cesarean section, I want to stick to vaginal delivery for this particular woman, then I can use fetal scalp electrodes. Like in countries like UK, you know, they are using this fetal scalp blood sampling also and fetal scalp electrode testing also, because they want to cut down on their rate of cesarean section. They don't want to do cesarean section until and unless they have ensured that the fetus is acidotic or hypoxic. So they follow it up one step further, right? So if the CTG trace becomes abnormal, they first check for the fetal scalp blood pH. And if the fetus is acidotic, then they do a cesarean section. Similarly, scalp electrodes that are placed to measure the fetal oxygen saturation, they can also be placed if the CTG is abnormal and you want to actually, avoid doing a cesarean section and stick to vaginal delivery. Okay, so that's been my time, friends. Goodbye for the day and see you tomorrow.